Wakefield. And it's just not, I think it should be clear, we only want this one kind of feel, and that's our intent. Is there a second to that?
Is there a second to the amendment?
I'll second that.
Okay, council discussion on the amendment. Council Graff.
I don't think there's anyone on this town council who believes that we would be now voting or recommending that a baseball field be included with the soccer field at Fort Williams. And I think that's all, if I understand this amendment, that's all it does is make clear that we're simply voting for a grass field that soccer, lacrosse, and field hockey could be played on without, at Fort Williams, without a Little League infield.
Anybody else? Council O'Neill.
Well, I'll just say that's my understanding also. Little League is not being contemplated at Fort Williams under this proposal.
Okay. Councilor Jordan.
That's the way I understand it also. And that would be the way I would be voting.
I have a concern if we limit the wording to three particular sports. Does that mean if somebody goes up there and plays, is throwing around a frisbee, that's not contemplated and we could have the Rangers removing them? I'm much more comfortable with the terminology multi-purpose playing field, and I think the dimensions that have been put out by our engineering consultants accommodate those three particular sports, but they certainly don't disclude, whatever the word is, other activities, exclude, thank you. I've talked too much. Other activities that might take place on that field. Councilor Graff?
I'm not going to speak for Councilor Cogshaw, but my understanding of her amendment was simply to make clear that there was not a skin Little League infield contemplated on this field. And I think it's very confusing when you look at alternative four, that has still a Little League infield, because I think we all recall that we fashioned collectively another option that wasn't really set out previously. And my understanding of the amendment is we're simply making sure that we're not relying on drawing four, it's drawing four without a Little League infield.
That's correct. That is my intention. And we are talking about organized sports, and as far as frisbee playing, we don't have any organized teams yet for that, and I'm sure that could be amended eventually. The bars have them, but we don't have juveniles, I think, having it. But
this is the council's turn. Thank you.
Primary purpose is to clarify the fact that those are the three sports that we're planning the construction for. And alternate four does not show that.
Councilor Linnell.
I mean, I have no problem with specifying no baseball, but I'm still comfortable with multi-purpose. I mean, people, and I don't mean this lightly, for lack of a better word. It's been a long day. But if you specify just soccer lacrosse, I mean, does that mean people can't walk their dog across the field? I mean, I don't know if we need to get into that.
Oh, come on.
Well, I'm not sure we need to specify. I mean, obviously, it's going to be a 60-yard by 100-yard or whatever it is field, and I don't know. Do we need to specify further? I'd like to know what other people think.
Okay, Councilor Graff.
Would the councilor accept the word primary that modifies a field primarily for the use of soccer, lacrosse, and field hockey? Because that, I think, espouses the intent of the individuals on the council, but doesn't make it so restrictive that if there's some very minor use of a frisbee or something else, that there's not some room. But I think it was very important of Councillor Cogshaw to point out that it's not a baseball infield. And if we put the word primary in front of that, then I don't think there should be a problem.
You're suggesting that it say primarily for soccer field house and lacrosse?
And without a field, without a Little League infield, and primarily for soccer, lacrosse, and field hockey. And then the intent is very clear.
So what is the wording to be? I think I proposed that it would be for soccer, field hockey, and lacrosse in an east-west orientation only, as illustrated in alternate four. Are you suggesting that I just say a soccer, field hockey, lacrosse field with the east-west orientation primarily for those sports as illustrated in alternate four? Eliminate,
if
drop the
personally,
element.
I would put in without a field developed without a baseball infield, and I'd insert that in that language.
Okay,
and then
why don't I withdraw my amendment, if you withdraw your second, and have you do the amendment. Otherwise, we'll be here to midnight.
Compromise is rampant.
Really, what you're doing is you're doing the multipurpose play field that's shown there, excluding the Little League
that's
field
all.
Shown in alternate four. Is that simple?
That's why he gets the big bucks.
That's why we pay him the big bucks.
Okay, so are you going to
do the
amendment, Joe?
Do we have some language for this amendment? You want to say that again, Mr. McGovern?
Yeah, it's
help the clerk.
Approves the proposed multipurpose playing field in Fort Williams Park and the approximate location set forth in alternate four for Fort Williams Park of the youth was turned to study, and then comma, excluding the Little League field shown on said plan. There's no good place to put it, but that takes care.
Well, you could put the comma under alternate four. It's closer.
Put the comma on after alternate four. Okay, we'll read. Approves the proposed multipurpose playing field in Fort Williams Park, in the approximate location set forth in alternate four, comma, excluding the Little League field shown on said plan, comma, for Fort Williams Park. Got that? How is that sitting?
That's fine. I'll make that motion for an amendment.
Second.
Further discussion on the amendment. Okay, further, Councilor Jordan.
I just can't seem to fathom here if you name three sports that is primarily for, and something else comes along, which will within a year or so, I think they do frisbee are they going to be kicked off because soccer or lacrosse or field hockey come along and want to play?
I
think you've got to be careful how you name the sports, but I'm in favor of excluding the Little League field because I think we'll build them one somewhere else.
I think with the language as presented, we're still calling it a multipurpose playing field. I think we've gotten out of that potential hole. Thank you. Okay, discussion on the main motion.
Can you repeat the main
motion? Yes, repeat the main motion.
Should we vote on the amendment first?
Let us vote on the amendment and then we'll proceed to the main motion. Everybody understanding what the amendment is? Okay. All those in favor of the amendment? Opposed? That was 7-0 for the revised amendment. Main motion, I believe, the Councillor Reed made was as was presented in the memo from the manager, as previously read by the chairman. Councillor Coxall?
Does this also include the conditions that were specified in that article, or do we deal with those separately?
My understanding was that those are part of the motion.
Yes, ma'am.
Do you have amendments, Councillor Coxall?
Yes, I do. That under condition number one, when they talk about the parking lot, that they remain unpaved so that we don't end up with large tarmac, particularly behind offices, row houses that ultimately could end up being paving, or to have the planning board even consider that it would be paved, that there be no concession stand. And I know in the other proposal it talked about Sunday hours. I'm willing to leave that out of my amendment, but I'm concerned about having paved parking lot as well as having concession stands set up in the general vicinity.
Okay, you've just clarified a little more about concession stands.
No concession stands.
Associated with the playing field?
Right.
Is that it? Okay.
At the fort.
Just at Fort Williams.
Just at Fort Williams.
Okay. Well, that's what we're talking about, I believe, is the Fort Williams field here. So no concession stand associated with the playing field, the multipurpose. Do we have a second on the amendments, Councilor Jordan?
Is a concession stand allowed in other playing areas of the fort?
I believe since we're just discussing this playing field location, that's the parameters around the discussion this evening.
Well, then why don't we have parameters around all the playing fields in the fort? So what, when you open this door here, that you can't have any at this field, possibly they can have them in the other fields, you're telling me.
This is dealing just with this plan.
Under the Fort Williams ordinance, that would be a new use within the park. It would need to go through a separate review process in order to get approved as a new use, any of those concessions.
So what are we accomplishing here?
We're dealing with this project only.
Well.
Madam Chairman.
Go ahead.
Councilor Reed and then Councilor.
Madam Chairman, I support Mr. Jordan's view. I think that it is not necessary to say no concession stand because that is a New Year's and the Fort Williams Advisory Commission would be involved in that. I'm concerned about the restriction about the lack of paving on the parking lot because those parking lots may at some point in time need to be paved for whatever reason, totally unrelated to ball fields, and I do not support and will not support any recommendation for no Sunday play.
Before we continue, do we have a second on this proposed amendment?
The amendment only deals with concession stand and paving of the parking lot.
Do we have a second on the amendment? I do not see any. Amendment fails for lack of a second. Mm-hmm. Anybody else have amendments? Or do you want to go to the Councilor Groff?
Under the conditions, under 9, I would like to see paragraph 9, 1, 2, 3, 4, the fifth line down, which reads, any scheduled activity using the field shall have at least one team made up predominantly of Cape Elizabeth youth. I think we're going to have some situations because of Casco Bay with, as Mr. Dunphy explained, where there might be an issue that, because we share with South Portland, there might be one team, one time, where it might not be predominantly Cape Elizabeth youth. And I think the way around that, because I don't think anybody wants to exclude that team, that's really a Cape Elizabeth team with South Portland from playing on that field, that we can insert the language, any scheduled activity using the field shall have at least one team sponsored for and including Cape Elizabeth youth. And I think that would certainly be the intent that I think we all were looking for.
I would second that.
Thank you. Discussion?
Yeah.
Councilor Nell?
Yeah, I think that's a great idea because there might be a time when you might have 4 very talented girls or boys on a team that need that much practice and exposure to a certain level of play, and I just think it would be a shame, if we went you know, way over to South Portland or something to get enough players to make up a team to deny them, deny those four girls or four boys a chance to play because of that stipulation. So I think it would certainly serve those players, and I think it's a good idea.
Thank you. Further discussion on the amendment? Where? That sentence would now read, any scheduled activity using the field shall have at least one team sponsored for and including Cape Elizabeth youth.
It's good.
All right. All those in favor of the proposed amendment? Opposed? 7-0. Any other amendments? Councilor Linnell.
I need to somebody to remind me where the Sunday issue is.
It's not.
It isn't.
It's not included in the proposed.
And I don't have an amendment.
Okay. Any other amendments, Councilor Groff?
Just a question. I certainly have no problem, and have had no problem for a long period of time, combining the building of this field in Fort Williams with making the rest of that area permanently passive, and also combining the making the designing and completion of this field with cleaning that area up, including removing the asphalt storage area and a lot of the other conditions. And I'm willing to do that in different ways, whether it's attached to this as more conditions or separate. But I think it's incredibly important for a consensus in this community that with this proposal for this field, this town council demonstrate a commitment to be sensitive to the remaining area that isn't field and dedicate and have a commitment to making the other parts adjacent to that field of that parcel better than they are now by heeding the wishes of a large majority of residents that that part of the park should be cleaned up and made more accessible for walking and more accessible for passive use. And I'm willing to put conditions here now, right now, to that effect. And I would like to see that tie into the fundraising effort and broaden the fundraising effort for that portion of the fort for not only making this playing field, but also if there's preservation of existing stone walls in that fort, if there's things that we can do in that part of the fort for a sense of history, I'm more than happy to make those fundraising efforts, lump them together also so that we can really truly have a consensus in this town and that this truly can be a win-win situation for all our citizens.
Councilor Reed.
Madam Chairman, my only concern with Councilor Groff's comments are that dating back to the 1990 Fort Williams master plan that was referenced by a speaker tonight, on page 7, I'll just read one paragraph regarding the Southwest Reserve quadrant of the park. Quote, this area has been neglected and is in need of significant pruning, clearing, selective thinning and or removal of vegetation. The overall condition of the vegetation is good. One of my concerns by putting conditions on this project for something like that is I don't think the burden of paying for something that has been long neglected and separate from the use that was proposed originally and now has become this should be a burden on whether or not the project, as stated, should go through. If Councilor Groff suggests that we have a separate fundraising effort so that people who want to preserve that area and can send money specifically for that purpose, I suggest we consider it as a totally separate project.
I would like to interject at this point, if you would allow me, to remind the council that we've gone through a lot of process to get to where we are this evening. A lot of citizens have gone through the process with us, and they've gone through process on their own accord. We do have another entity that we need to bring into this kind of discussion, and that's our Fort Williams Advisory Commission. I would, for one, would be quite uncomfortable imposing conditions that so directly relate to the advisory work we expect from that group without giving them the chance to do that first and come back to us. I'm sure we can find an appropriate way to include in what we, the information, the material we send to them, what the discussion has been this evening and what some of the thinking has been, but I cannot be a supporter of putting words into the mouth of that advisory commission at this point. Councilor Now.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I guess I'm with Councilor Groff in spirit and practically speaking, also mindful of the hour, and I would have to agree with Councilor Reed. I think there are some very some valid concerns that have been brought up by the compromise group, and I think I would tend to agree generally with the spirit of what they're looking at, some more buffer and so forth, and I'm not dodging it. I'm just saying I'm not sure it would be best to get into it tonight, and people know that I don't dodge issues, so I'm really not. I think that's something we can look at, but I don't think we should get right into that whole thing tonight.
Councilor Groff?
I did not make an amendment. I simply wanted, I didn't want this meeting to end for us not to have some affirmative message for those citizens who work so hard to try to come to a compromise. And I think if what we're telling those individuals is that this is going to come back, and that the Fort Williams Advisory Commission will be looking at this issue, that the council will continue to look at this issue with the Fort Williams Advisory Commission of having the rest of that portion of the park reach its potential, and not be in a way that's being suggested by that group. That's plenty for me. And we don't have to get into it tonight, but I just thought it was an important statement to make that we're just not approving this and dismissing their concerns out of hand.
Thank you. Councilor Jordan?
I just want to say that I agree with Councilor Groff, and that's the way I understood it. I didn't think that he wanted us to start changing the plans. Now that we move forward and keep that in mind, and I also would like to, and I think we owe it to the elderly people that like to walk around the park, and I think someday that if the manager could had somebody that was good with a ruler and figures, that let's give these people that feel that it should retain as open space. How much open space is left in the park? There's quite a lot there if you stop to figure it all out, down by the ocean and over by Garden Mansion, and also the area that's going around by Delano Park. In building this, they will screen that somewhat, so they'll have to peek between the trees to watch the athletics going on in the field.
Thank you, Councilor. Mr. McGovern?
If I might respond to that, Councilor Jordan, as I mentioned earlier, in 1976, I think it was, when you were served on the council, one of your earliest stints, you and the other members of the council dedicated as permanent open space almost the whole ocean portion of the park on the inside of, on the ocean side of the road, the entry field going in, a lot of the playground area. One of the difficulties we've had as staff is really trying to figure out what that all means. And, you know, maybe this is a real opportunity to better define what that means, and then for the council to look comprehensively at all, is the master plan entailed of all of those areas, and really, you know, comprehensively preserve them in the way the community wants them preserved. But, you know, right now we've got, you got to look here, you got to look there, and it's a mess really trying to figure out what happened, why it happened, and when it happened. And we know when, but aside from that, we really don't know. So I don't know, I see this as a real opportunity to try to pull it all together so that we not only preserve these spaces, but we're really clear in what we're preserving in the other spaces as well that have been permanently dedicated.
Thank you. Councilor Coxell?
Yes. I am going to vote for this proposal tonight, and my reason is, even though I would not like to see construction of fields in Fort Williams Park, this particular multipurpose field, I think, will enhance that particular area, provided the other conditions are also acted upon. I've made private inquiries of other landowners to see if there was any possibility of having fields constructed or land purchased for them, or a lease purchase agreement, and many of them are not interested in this type of facility. And I must say, after last year's very contentious and very difficult hearing, I am so proud of the democratic process that the compromise that's been proposed by these neighbors is a true example of the democratic process that I think as a town we can really be proud that we took a positive action on everyone's part and not just trying to maintain our line as they do in other parts of the world no matter what. I would like to see this motion also have a caveat to go to the Fort Williams Committee that perhaps in reviewing this process that they also receive from Mr. Berman and his group their list of conditions they'd like to see considered. It would just help to broaden the whole approach and I think give the Fort Williams Committee and Planning Board a better idea of how much of a compromise this is.
Councilor McGinty?
I would also like to commend the consensus group, or what it's called, that obviously did a lot of work and brought a lot of people together. I personally would like to see this formalized and sent. If I understand the original motion, we're sending this to the Planning Board and the Fort Williams Advisory Commission. Mm-hmm. If that's the case, why can't they look at all these conditions in the course of reviewing the whole project? And I would, we're sending it for their comments, and why can't they comment on it now?
Councilor Nell?
Well, I think certainly Mr. Berman could pass that on to them, or does it have to go through us technically? But they can look at it. But they, I'm not sure they'll have time to really wrestle with it between now and September. They can. I have a question. Okay. Can Mr. Berman pass this on to them, or does it have to technically be passed on through from us?
I think it's more appropriate if it's passed on through the council. It can be added to the conditions that the council has in the motion, or it can be included separately as a communication received from a private group.
Thank you.
Councilor Jordan?
Well, I just got to end this little discussion here. So maybe we can move on to the lady in the front here that spoke about the old days when they used a rock for a base bath. And I went through those years and what have you, and we used other things for big baths too, once you went over the fence and got into cow pasture.
Thank you. Councillor Reed.
I just have a question regarding Councilor McGinty's comment about sending both of these as though they were both viable options and have the Planning Board consider. Do we have the supporting information regarding the studies, the cost estimates, et cetera, that go with Mr. Berman's that need to be considered for a side-by-side comparison?
I respond to that. We don't specifically, and you know, I think, you know, you know, if you go with the motion that's on the floor, you're talking September 1st, and you know, their proposal, you know, it's what's been talked about a lot over the years, and it, you know, if it's the will of the council and the people, it does need to move forward, but it really needs there's some major policy decisions there that ought not, I'm trying to think of a polite word, that need to be carefully detailed. I think if there's a rush to it, you know, just in figuring out the exact parameters of the area, it doesn't include the parking lot, doesn't include the garages. It really needs to be mapped, and it needs to be annotated as to what is being preserved. And, do we want to get into a Governor Baxter situation with Baxter State Park, forever wild, nothing to be done? You know, and then someone comes along and they want to improve the path a little bit through the woods in the back there. Those types of things take time to think through, and they're not going to do it between now and September 1. And some of it would, rebuilding the stone walls, that is a lot of money, as Mr. Berman pointed out.
This council had a workshop, which the chairman of the Fort Williams Advisory Commission attended, sometime in the past 2 or 3 months. At that time, we asked that commission to come back to us, I believe, in October with some further information. I would be comfortable in passing on to them the comments that we've received tonight. We would get them in written form from the group represented this evening by Mr. Berman. I think we have to give the Fort Williams Commission time to look at the long-term ramifications of what is being proposed. That is how we do policy in this town, and sometimes we feel like we're beating it to death, but it serves us all really well in the long run, as I hope everybody in this room can appreciate, and I would hate to hold everything else hostage, basically, to waiting for the Fort Williams Commission to take the appropriate long-term view of what's being proposed tonight. I appreciate Mr. Groff bringing it up. I understand the need to address the concerns put forward this evening. I think it might be more appropriate to have it be something a bit separated out from the motion. Councilor Lyle?
Yeah, I agree with you. I think it might be appropriate to just pass along the comments at this point, but not sort of muddy the waters by asking them to jump through all these hoops by September.
I think we've heard from the manager that there has not been a clear definition, and that's perhaps another part of better defining what permanently dedicated open space is. I was just lucky enough to have in my pile the map that shows the permanently dedicated open space and the dedicated recreation space for Fort Williams. And there's some slashed this way, there's some slashed that way, and there's some white. And I hate to just say, go ahead, put some more slashes on it, and that means permanent open space. It needs to be looked at comprehensively. I was redundant, I'm sorry.
Move the question.
All those in favor of moving the question?
Oh.
Motion. All those in favor of moving the question, you have to vote on that. I read the rules today, don't you? All those in favor of taking a vote on the motion.
The original motion.
The original motion as amended. 7-0. Okay. The motion as it stands has one amendment. Is that correct?
Two.
Oh, jeez. It's two amendments.
Ooh.
Yes. It does. Would you read us back the amendments?
So I understand it. Please correct me. Chairman McLaughlin read the proposed motion in your packet. It has been amended to the first and the second degree.
Thank you.
The first amendment is on page one. Be it further ordered that Senate should read that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council approves the proposed multipurpose playing field in Fort Williams Park and the approximate location set forth in alternate four, comma, excluding the Little League field as shown in said plan, comma, for Fort Williams Park, etc. The second motion was under conditions number 9, approximately the fifth sentence down. That sentence would read, is the intent that the field shall be for Cape Elizabeth youth. I'm sorry, the next sentence. Any scheduled activity using the field shall have at least one team sponsored for and including Cape Elizabeth youth. Both of those amendments were moved and seconded and voted by the council. So you have your main motion with two amendments.
Okay. Is there any question? All those in favor of the motion as amended? All those opposed? 7-0. Thank you. This will be sent to the Fort Williams Advisory Commission and the Planning Board with the recommendations to come back to this council no later than September 1. We will have another public hearing September 9. Thank you. Thank you for your perseverance in the audience this evening. We need to look at item number 33, consideration of playing field funding alternatives. I would entertain a motion, and we can have discussion on item 33. No motion?
I have questions.
You don't want the motion passed?
Questions.
If I made a motion, it would be different from that. All right. I'll make a motion.
Councillor Reed.
Madam Chairman, I move that the town be responsible for 100% of the legal expenses incurred in the multipurpose playing field construction. I recommend that the town match 50 cents on the dollar, all money raised, and I suggest that the town consider a commitment of 10 years forward from Little League and youth soccer in lieu of an initial outlay being guaranteed.
Second.
Thank you. Could we have discussion, please? Councillor Graff?
I think Councillor Reed talked about the multipurpose field, but I assume she's talking about the multipurpose field and the field at Lions Field.
Yes.
So that would be an amendment to the motion?
Would you like to restate your motion? That part of it?
The multi-purpose playing field and the Little League field under consideration.
Is that the understanding of the second? Yes, it is. Thank you. Councillor Graff?
My concern is that I don't want monies raised and one field or the other field completed and one field left with no monies. In other words, both groups come together, they raise the monies. Say Fort Williams is the, or Lions Field, either way. But one field gets built before the other, and then the fundraising effort runs out of steam. I would suggest that the way the two groups be kept together and the town be kept together is that there be escrow funds established, and whenever any monies are raised, the monies go into an escrow fund for each field in proportion to the projected cost for the fields. Because if you do it any other way, then you're going to be in a situation where you're going to leave one group high and dry.
Councillor Reed?
I share Councillor Graff's concern, except I do think that it would be appropriate at least to have the discussion that money raised by Little League for users' fees at a rate of $10 per person per year be dedicated to the construction of the Little League field, and that users' fees for lacrosse, field hockey, if applicable, and youth soccer for field use be so stated and be used for that field. And one of my concerns about this is I think it is inappropriate, after waiting all this time, to hold up this project when, how old is Lions Field? 25 years? Playstead Park,
at least.
The field over there, Family Field, is
I
how
I played on both of them in the 50s.
They're really old.
So did my brother.
Wow.
My concern is that this burden should be shared by future children using, as opposed to just the children and the parents that are currently in town. And I would suggest that if the organized teams, including now girls and boys lacrosse teams, add a surcharge, if you will, for field development for the next 10 years, then we will be able to pay for these without undue hardship fundraising for current residents, current businesses, and delay further the construction for current needs.
Councillor Graff?
I have no problem with that proposal, but I don't think the economics will quite be enough money. I think that what we can do is I would vote for that proposal. But on top of that, I think there's going to be some fundraising necessary, even with that proposal.
Yes.
And all I'm addressing is that other aspect of the financing, of that additional fundraising, that we have a mechanism where there's monies being set aside for both fields rather than just one being completed and one left high and dry. So I can adopt what you're saying, but it's a separate step on top of that.
I agree.
Councilor Jordan?
I had a question in my mind when John Chapman was speaking, and he spoke of the $10, and is that just for Little League? There's no charge for any other sports for the youngsters, do you know?
That's part of our registration fee.
That's part of yours. But if anybody plays lacrosse or something like that, they don't have that. Okay, thank you. Okay.
I believe Mr. Chapman was speaking only as a representative of Little League.
Okay, that's what I thought, but I wanted to clear it up to any of the others do charge, and he says $70. I think we ought to have a breakdown of what sports do charge each one of the youngsters, if any. I think it'd be helpful.
Okay. Councilor Coxell?
Yes, how would we allocate the in-kind services? There is more needed in one area than the other. And if you had the same individual who's willing to do it all at once, would you be able to reduce the amount? Maybe Michael can answer this. And I just want to make one comment that there were statements by several people tonight about the fundraising being much more difficult to do. I can see where it would be because some of the momentum has been lost. But you're only being asked to possibly raise $25,000 more than what was proposed in money or in-kind services. So it's not as astronomical as you kind of made it believe. I realize you've lost your momentum. But I think with what we're doing here tonight, that can be regained. With the right attitude, it can.
Thank you. Councilor Reed, your hand was up.
No. No. Sorry.
Councilor McGinty?
I have a concern here that, we obviously want to be fair, and there's a lot of issues about the difference in the cost for either field. But I have a concern that maybe we're imposing or tying the hands of the people who can do the fundraising prematurely, that maybe we need to sit down with them and see how they would like to handle how much money, how much of the fee. We don't have Mr. Duffy here anymore to talk about the soccer people, how much they may be willing to contribute or not, or the in-kind services, how that may work out between the two fields. I'm wondering if we really need to sit down with the people who are going to actually do the fundraising and discuss this, rather than us, impose our will on them. I really have a concern about that.
I personally think that makes a lot of sense. I think we might be being a bit premature this evening in trying to create a creature, and we don't quite have our hands fully around the creature. Mr. McGovern, you wanted to
I was going
to
say something similar. I think the real, you're not going to be voting on this finally until September, but I think the real key issue here is you're giving a message that the town is willing to commit $150,000. That's the real key message. Beyond that, I tried to come up with something, and I purposely, writing this, did not contact any of these folks because for two reasons. One is because I feel it's my job to do what's best for the town and the town purse strings. And I don't want to be in a situation 2 years from now that I've got something under construction and it's half done and there isn't any money and the council comes to see me, why the heck did you let that get so out of control? I want to avoid that. And these things happen and everyone has the best of intentions, but they happen and I'm looking out for the town's interests 2 years hence. Second thing I wanted to say is that I would really, if in fact this is going to go forward, and I've been accused of bias and all the other things, which hopefully I haven't been, but if in fact you direct me to work with the group, I'd be happy to do it. And if in fact there is a group now that wants to provide some sort of alternate, but I'm going to be looking out for the town's interests if that's the case. And the town's interest, as I see it, is I don't want to be left with the taxpayers ending up supporting more to get both fields done than this council intended. That's the objective I'd be looking for. And I'd be looking to safeguard that.
I'm a bit concerned. I don't believe there are any members of the compromise and consensus group left in the audience, but I was so hoping that they had also delved into the fundraising part component of this, and perhaps they need to be included in such conversations, even though they seem to have departed this evening. Councilor Graff, your hand was...
This one left.
Yourself?
Yeah.
Could you come to the microphone if you're going to speak, please?
Yeah, I was involved with the
compromise. Excuse me, we need your name.
My name is Bob Dodd, and since I'm reporting for the Cape Courier tonight, rather than make my comments appear more elegant in writing than they should have been, Richard Berman and I met together with Roy Dunphy and with John just before the meeting and discussed the compromise plan. So I was involved in the whole thing. Yeah. But the specific question of fundraising, yeah, we felt that as a group that if we could get in principle and in concept this idea of a total vision for that area accepted, that that we as a group felt that as far as we represented the people who were concerned about the use of that part, that we would be very active in promoting the fundraising efforts for that, and that we felt that this was a joint plan, it was a consensus plan, and that as part of the responsibility of that, we had a responsibility to be involved with the fundraising, to support it, you know, not to be involved with the planning of the fundraising, but to support the fundraising of the fields people.
Okay.
Is that the question
that helps.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, and that was very much an issue, and we felt that if this vision for the area was accepted, that was, I guess, our part of the bargain, that we felt it was our responsibility to be involved with supporting the whole concept and therefore supporting the fundraising efforts.
Okay, thank you very much.
In any way we could.
The clarification. Councilor Graff, you had your hand up.
Well, I think there's other issues with fundraising, because I think what's also going to happen when you really start to look at fundraising, that various corporations and entities would probably be willing to pay money if in fact there was some permanent recognition. And that doesn't mean signs, that doesn't mean, but it might be something as simple as a plaque where there's medallions for a plaque a foot by a foot, where there's medallions for corporations that's contributed funds to help us build this field. So I think there's a lot of unanswered questions yet in the fundraising, and perhaps what we could do is make the motion much more simple. And it is proposed that town funds be expended in an amount to be agreed upon by the council at a subsequent date upon appropriate assurance that there will be completion of the projects. And leave it that broad for right now, because we're going to revisit this anyway. And we could put a number in for the town council, but leave it that broad.
Councilor Linnell?
Yeah, I think we ought to leave some wiggle room there, but I think it would be good for us to, for example, for those trying to fundraise, having lost a lot of steam, I think it might be useful to throw out if we're talking about a half the town matching, I think we ought to, it might be useful to say $150,000, and we could direct the manager to work on some more, hammer out some more of the details, work looking at some of the town's, protecting the town's interests, and suggest that they, you know, we take a look at the $6,000 a year and so forth, some of those issues. But I think it would be useful to give them to know that the town council is willing to commit to, say, half the price, which is approximately $150,000.
Okay, thank you. We do have, see if I get to where you need to be. We do have a motion on the floor made by Councillor Reed, seconded, I believe, by Councillor McGinty. Councilor Nell, somebody. We've had discussion on that, and I think there have been a few changes to it. I haven't heard any changes to the formal motion, however. We can have that motion withdrawn, or we can vote on it.
Could I,
Councilor Nell?
As one of the motioners.
You were the seconder?
The seconder. Yeah, I think we might, I think maybe we ought to modify it or withdraw it and start over, if that's...
If you'll remember, nobody was willing to dare. I did. Go ahead.
No, I commend you for that. How about...
Is that a withdrawal of the motion?
That's a withdrawal with grace.
Very graceful, and we appreciate your stepping to the fore when I so sorely needed it. Councilor Nell?
I'll take a stab at it, okay? Something about...
good start.
The town would be 100% responsible for any legal expenses that may occur. The town would commit to a half, 50% of the funding, or approximately $150,000. And we would direct the manager to hammer out come up with some more suggestions and details of the potential fundraising issues or something like that.
I'm not going to second that.
Good for you.
You took a stab at it.
Hey, well.
Is there a second for that motion?
Is Debbie fine-tune it?
I think Debbie's written the motions.
The manager will.
How about this?
Councilor Graff?
How about it is proposed in addition that the town be 100% responsible for any legal expenses that may occur. It is proposed that the town funds be expended in a matching amount of up to $150,000 upon adequate assurance that the fields will be completed as designed. And that leaves plenty of wiggle room and sends up an appropriate message.
I'll second that.
Thank you. Since the manager is going to have to be deeply involved in this, I'd like to get his...
Yeah, I think that motion's fine, but I would move it forward by talking to all the interested parties. But I wanted to say before, I think there's lots of innovative things could be done. We laugh about that big pile of asphalt that everyone looks at as a piece of junk, but that's also very, very valuable. And, maybe one of the compromises in this could be something to the effect that the value of that, when we remove it, could be put into rebuilding the stone walls in the area or something like that, so that, there's all sorts of win-win possibilities in this. And, we can try to figure out something between now and September.
Okay. Councilor Jordan?
How could, are these figures figured with increased costs? To 97?
There's a contingency of $10,660. They also put in a construction contingency as well.
Okay. I want everybody to understand.
Councilor Reed?
I just wanted to reiterate to please consider future users and not have the burden of this fall entirely on the current users.
I hate to prolong this, getting late, but one of the talk about the 10-year Little League, there were some very important comments made tonight on demographics. And if you look at the demographics 8 years out, there aren't going to be as many kids in Little League as there are today. There just won't be that much of a pool. So we need to spend some time on this and be extremely careful. I'm agreeable with the general philosophy, but as you know from your private career, actuarially, we've got to make sure some of these assumptions are sound.
I agree.
Thank you. Councilor Coxall, put your hand up. Councilor Graff?
It's my understanding that the motion now before the council doesn't preclude any of these subsequent discussions, and it's a broad enough umbrella to have all these discussions later.
Any further discussion?
Move the question.
All those in favor of moving the question? 7-0. Can we have a second? Okay. Thank you. There's a request for you to read the motion.
Sorry.
That the town would be responsible for 100% of legal expenses that the town's funds be expended in a matching of amount of up to $150,000 upon adequate assurances that the fields will be completed as designed.
All right. Everybody understand the motion? All those in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Thank you. We have two other items relating to fields. At this point, I would request a tabling motion on those to the September meeting. One is item 34, reauthorizing acceptance of private funds, and item number 35 is authorization of design of playing fields.
Can I ask a question? Why would we table authorizing private funds at this point? Yeah. If somebody wants to come forward and give the town a bundle of money, I'm all for taking it.
We still have the old authorization to accept funds. This was just, you know, in case there was any issue that should the town be in the collection business again, it just gave the council a chance to revisit it. But in the meantime, the old authorization is still in place. It just is a double check in the system to be sure that, yes, you still want this done. Plus, there's also an issue that the Field for Cape Kids group no longer exists, as far as I know. So we're going to have to do some transferring of funds, and other details are going to need to be worked out. But we can still accept funds in the meantime.
Okay.
It just won't be by that formula that was suggested earlier.
Councilor Reid.
And who do people make the check payable to?
Town of Cape Elizabeth, so it's fully tax deductible.
Thank you.
Councilor McGinty.
Madam Chair, I move that we table item number 34 and item number 35 to the September 9th meeting.
Second.
Sorry. Thank you. For a motion and a second. It's a tabling motion. There is no discussion. All those in favor? All those opposed? 7-0. Thank you. We're staying with Fort Williams Park. Item 36. Request from Maine Office of Tourism for QVC broadcast on September 14, 1996. There was information about this in your council packet, included in the minutes from the Fort Williams Commission. Are there any questions from the council?
Mentioned that Nancy Sears, a member of the Fort Williams Advisory Committee, has patiently been waiting, representing the commission.
Would you like to speak to us on this one? Yes, you do, please. And we appreciate your patience.
Nancy Sears, 17 Linwood Street, Fort Williams Advisory Committee. We were very impressed with the presentation given to us about, is it QVC or whatever those initials
yes,
are?
Yes, it is.
We had members from the State Bureau of Tourism and the State Film Department or whatever. Mm-hmm. They gave us a very nice presentation, and we were very impressed with what they had to say. They assured us that they are extremely careful as to the property that they're using. I believe, for instance, they were talking about, what's that big resort up in Rockland?
Samoset.
Yeah, the Samoset. And they were not going to bring their heavy trucks over a certain roadway up there. They were going to break things down onto smaller trucks. And they're very careful. We were impressed with how careful they would be doing this. And we felt that it was good for the state of Maine. They're going to be the products they're going to be selling are all state of Maine products. And I don't recall what our vote was. I think it was unanimous that we wanted to go ahead and recommend this.
Great. Thank you very much. Are there any
questions? I might as well stay here in case you have another.
Yes.
The next one is.
Are there any questions for Sear? Councilor Coghlan?
Yes, I just wondered where they're going to possibly be setting up the seating for up to 500 people.
Well, this was, now let me see, they want the lighthouse in the background somehow, and We had talked about, you know, the circle as cars come in and go around the circle there. We did not want the general public not to have use of that. If people needed to still come in, they could. And I am sorry, I can't recall where that was going to be. I think possibly on the field where they sometimes set up tents and have governor's receptions and so forth.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Are there any further questions from the council? Ms. Sears? Okay. I'd entertain a motion at this point.
Madam Chairman.
Council Coxell.
I move that we accept the recommendation of the Fort Williams Advisory Commission to have the QVC television program broadcast from Fort Williams Park, Saturday, September 14th, 1996.
I'll second.
Thank you. Further discussion? All those in favor? All those opposed? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 37 is a review of the Cliff Walk concept and authorization of the planning for that to continue. Mr. McGovern?
Nancy's here as well on this one. I just, you know, I think as the council is aware, a private donor who has not been publicly announced has indicated a willingness to donate the funds for this. The committee has had five or six meetings with a designer and now have a concept that was detailed in your agenda. Before we went ahead and did much more work, I just wanted you to be aware of it. Again, I don't think it's ever been really publicly discussed at a council meeting before, but just for you to be aware of it, for the public to be aware of it, if anyone wants to come in and see the material, they can. And I also do really want to thank Jeff Van Fleet, the chairman of the Fort Williams Advisory Commission, who has really taken a leadership role in, on this particular issue and has had several meetings in addition with the commission, with the donor, regularly keeping the donor informed and working with Tom Emery of Land Use Consultants as well.
I would just like to add that the donor has offered a certain amount of money. He has not said that he will give us a total amount. I mean, we are working with an amount of money that he has suggested, and we are still looking at this carefully. Will we do a part of it with that amount of money and hope to get fundraising or other donors? I mean, we don't expect that the amount of money he's talking about is going to complete the whole walk in one fell swoop. This may take a while.
Thank you. I would entertain a motion. Councilor Groff?
The council authorized the planning by the Fort Williams Advisory Commission concerning the Cliff Walk to continue.
Second.
Continue.
Second. I heard you the first time.
Council discussion. All those in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank the commission for us, please. Item 38, to consider setting a public hearing on the Pedals and Pedestrians Committee report for August 12, 1996. This is a report that we received at our last meeting, I believe. And Councilor Reed?
Madam Chairman, I move that we set to public hearing the Pedals and Pedestrian Committee report for our August 12, 1996 meeting at the Town Hall at 7:30.
Second.
Mr. McGinty was very anxious to second that. Council discussion. Councilor Groff.
If I recall, when this was presented to us, some of the individuals who presented it said their major concern was safety and referenced the fact that there were two safety experts who provided conflicting views, and at that time, it was the consensus of the council that it was very necessary for the council to review the reports of the experts to make any sense of the underlying report. And I have not been provided with those expert reports, and I assume that we are going to be provided with them expeditiously, or is my assumption in error?
If you're looking at me, I'll try to get copies of them. I don't believe I have them.
I have the same recollection, Councilor Graff, that we were not given all the information that went to the Pedals and Pedestrians Committee, and that was my request at the last meeting, that we be given all the information, and sooner rather than later.
We'll probably have to send it out to a printer.
Have a public hearing. Councilor Reed.
It's a one-page report. I just wanted you to know that it was not two professional safety engineers. It was one professional safety engineer and one citizen's opinion who had conflicting information, for the record.
Okay, thank you. Councilor Reed, since you were a member of that committee, is there other information that was provided to that committee that is not discernible from the report?
Yes, ma'am. I believe that there is a tremendous amount of information that was paid for by the grant that would be very important to the decision, and I would suggest that if you would like that information, I have a full packet of material, and you could either ask me to provide what I think is extremely important, and I'd be very happy to do that, or the paid consultant, I'm sure, has it all at his fingertips. We paid a lot of money for a lot of information that is not contained in that report.
I remain concerned. I will get repetitious and reiterate that I would like all of the information that was provided to that committee be provided to the council, and would ask the manager to be in touch with the consultant and make sure that all the councilors receive the full information. Councilor Cogshill?
Yes, we're setting this for a public hearing. I hope that we have consulted with that committee to make sure they all will be available for that meeting. And are we going to workshop this before we have a public hearing and have a vote?
I think what might be judicious for this council to consider, knowing everybody's upcoming schedule, is to have a workshop after the public hearing and put the vote off until September. Reconsideration. Councilor Linnell, your hand was up.
I don't know. But I would like to see, with that information, if the manager or the consultant, our well-paid consultants, could get it. I'd like to see included the latest on this critical rate factor business for the town, what the latest is for the roadways that are contemplated, because I know this is something that I had looked up a year or two ago. Mm-hmm. And I'd like to know what the latest is on the critical rate factor for these roads from the MDOT or state police, whoever has it.
Okay, thank you. There are two upcoming items on tonight's agenda also related to this. What we're looking at right now is the public hearing on the report. Councilor
Linnell? Well, I just wondered if we can ask the manager if he doesn't mind, if he has any thoughts on the workshop, whether it would be prudent before, during, or after. If I'm not, I don't mean to put you on the spot.
I don't care.
And why would he?
I don't have a problem with doing it after the public hearing. And we have a pretty full agenda.
Councilor Cogshill.
I would like to see us leave these as setting it for public hearing. If we wish to table it till September, we can. Mm-hmm. At least we'll have the option to vote next month. And I also wanted to ask the manager, what is the deadline on accepting these grants, if they still exist? Or if they still exist?
The grants still exist. The state has asked for a definitive decision by September 30th. it is my personal preference, so you resolve it at the September meeting, because I think most of you are aware, I'm going on vacation for 2 weeks. I'm here for 5 days, and I'm on vacation for 2 weeks, and I just, my sense is whatever you vote, there's going to be a lot of follow-up and a lot of work that needs to be done, regardless of your vote, and it'd be very difficult if I was overseas while you were.
Are you talking about reserving it in September, the vote in September or in August?
As long as it's voted by the September council meeting, that's
okay.
But if you, sure, my concern is if you delay it to a later meeting in September, then it begins to cause problems with follow-up.
Right.
I don't think the state would have a problem, but I would in terms of making sure everything that needed to get done got done.
Councilor Jordan?
So, as I take it, that we need a workshop before September.
That is preferable.
Yeah.
Highly preferable.
So,
I would like to see one in August sometime.
Yes, sir. We do have two workshops already scheduled in August for the Joint Council Planning Board review of the zoning ordinance. We could convert one of those to a workshop to include review of this report, or we could set another workshop in August. I'm pushing for August because of my personal schedule for the rest of July after this week. Councilor Coxell?
I move the question.
Those in favor of voting on the question? And what we are voting on is to set to public hearing the Pedals and Pedestrians Committee report at our August 12th meeting. All those in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 39 is to consider setting a public hearing on the recommendations of the Pedals and Pedestrian Committee Committee regarding Shore Road Bikeway. Have that August 12, 1996.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor?
Thought we just done it. Yeah. Don't understand.
All those opposed? 7-0. Item number 40, consider setting a public hearing on the recommendations of the Pedals and Pedestrian Committee regarding Two Lights Road Bikeway for August 12, 1996 at Town Hall at 7:30.
So moved.
Second.
Questions? Discussion? All those? Councilor Coxell?
I'm voting.
Oh.
Participating.
Councilor McGinty, are you voting?
I'm voting.
All those in favor, let's vote. All those opposed? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 41, to consider the adoption of the annual town council goals. And we had a workshop discussion about the goals at the end of June. Let me just summarize the goals. I would also like to break out, my recollection was that we were calling some of these continuing action and not goals, and I do think that's got some importance to that distinction. I would also like to read what my understanding was of the counselors who were shepherding the individual goals or continuing action. For budget, I believe I had my notes that was a continuing action to be shepherded along by Councilor McGinty and Councilor Jordan. The substance abuse goal was to be shepherded by Councilors Linnell and McGinty. Recreation and playing fields under the auspices of Councilors Graff and Reed. The Thomas Jordan property to be taken care of, to be shepherded by Councilors Coggeshall and Linnell. Fort Williams Park to be under the auspices of Councilors Coggeshall and McLaughlin. Communications to be a continuing action to be shepherded by Councilors Reed and McLaughlin. The zoning ordinance rewrite work to be shepherded by Councilors Coggeshall and McLaughlin. Continuing action on an active program to recognize community volunteers and employees under the auspices of Councilors Graff and Jordan. The issues about the town center sidewalk and drainage improvement program to be attended to under the auspices of Councilors Reed and Coggeshall. And the rest of that looks like continuing action about the council being policy focused, assisting the manager in efforts to ensure a high-quality, productive staff, and the council will receive a report from the manager outlining steps taken working with students to develop a plan for student recognition. Would entertain a motion.
I move that we adopt these town council goals.
Second.
1996-97.
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Item number 42 is in conjunction with the recreation plan goal. This is to have the Community Services Advisory Commission develop a recreation plan for the town. This item will be to formally make the request to the commission.
Just so we don't have to hire a consultant.
We have people who have deep interests in the recreation plan for the town. We have two counselors shepherding, looking at recreation and playing fields, and we have an advisory commission already in place. We'd like to take advantage of our very talented volunteers. Councilor McGinty.
I move that the town council formally request the Community Services Advisory Commission to develop a recreation plan for the town.
Second motion.
Discussion. Councilor Cogswell.
I would like to say comprehensive recreation plan, so that we're really encompassing passive. I just think it's more complete if you say comprehensive. Meets all the needs.
I'll amend my motion to.
Thank you.
That
thank you. The motioner and the seconder are in accord with that.
Yes.
Any other comments or questions? Discussion. All those in favor? All those opposed? 7-0. Thank you. Propose to add an item, take an item out of order this evening, item number 43, as was at your places when you arrived. It's a recommendation from the Appointments Committee to fill a vacancy in the Fort Williams Advisory Commission. Could I have a motion for taking it out of order, Councilor Reed?
So moved.
Second.
Well done. All those in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Thank you. Councilor Reed, you're chairman of the Appointments Committee.
Yes, Madam Chair, I would like to thank the Town Council for allowing us to have this on the agenda tonight. Due to the three-day work week last week and scheduling during July, it was difficult to get both the applicant and the group of the Appointments Committee together, but we enthusiastically bring forward the name of Daniel Fisher of 2 Pheasant Hill Road as the Fort Williams Advisory Commission member who will serve the term of our current Town Councilor Joe Gruff. And I would appreciate consideration and approval of this recommendation.
Do I hear
a second? I'll second the motion.
Thank you. One question, Councilor Gruff, when does that term end? You remember?
3 years. So I just went on.
You just started? Okay.
I was on a matter of months. I think I have the record for the shortest serving member.
I think Councilor Marvin might, former Councilor Marvin might tie you for that, actually, for something. Councilor McGinty.
Were other people interviewed? Were there other candidates or applicants for this position? And
considered, but not interviewed.
So other applicants, though, were considered?
Considered.
One other question.
Yes,
had Mr. Fisher previously applied for this position?
No.
So the date 7-8 is actually when he applied for this position?
That's when he put it in writing.
When in writing, yeah.
He had previously expressed interest.
Okay.
But that formal application.
And he is no longer associated with Little League, and so now has the time available to do that, whereas before he felt that was a time commitment that he couldn't make.
Yes. Councilor Linnell.
Yeah, as I serve on the Appointments Committee and I'm a former chairperson, and when what we do is commonly is if we recruit And if we know of someone that has an interest in one of the positions, and we think there would be a good match for the position, we will talk to them and find the position. We don't necessarily put an ad in all the media and so forth, because if we know of someone that would be a good fit, we put them in the spot.
Any further discussion? Councilor Jordan.
No, I just want to ask the Appointments Committee, do you have any names that has come forward in the past that is interested?
We had 6 no's and 1 I'd love to. I have the time now.
6 no's. In the past, I didn't want to do it.
No, in the past week and a half. As I was reminded by the town manager's secretary that we need to have this position filled because they are meeting now without their full complement, and she encouraged me to get on with the process, so we went back to our list of previous names and looked for people who would be willing. And this is the one who stepped up.
Okay.
Councilor McGinty?
Is there a motion on the floor?
Yes, there is.
Yes. Okay.
Further discussion? All those in favor? All those opposed? 7-0. Thank you. Mr. McGovern?
Yeah, just if I could clarify the process that you used, particularly for the new councillor. Generally, we advertise at the direction of the Appointments Committee all of the annual vacancies. We also advertise all of the special committees. We do not advertise the vacancies during the year, and usually the Appointments Committee uses the pool of those who were applied and weren't appointed, and they also go out and recruit people. So in case anyone's watching and wondering what goes on, that is the process.
Thank you for the clarification. Councillor Reid.
So may I use this opportunity for a commercial announcement?
No.
How commercial?
Well, due to a resignation, we also have an opening on the school SDOC committee that has recently been announced, and that is also very close to the full term of the Service Option Delivery Study Committee. And that's due to a person moving out of state.
And are seeking applicants to fill that term.
And if anyone would call me who has an interest, I'd appreciate it very much.
Very good. Thank you. They can also get a job description for that
at the
committee
town manager's
from
office.
The manager's office. Thank you.
If they're watching now, they can call 799-5251, and we won't answer the phone, but there'll be a voicemail message, and we'll respond to it as soon as we can.
We are coming into modern technology. This is the time for citizen discussion of items not on the agenda.
I'll second.
All those in favor? We are adjourned. 7-0. Thank you.
Made it.
Do you need direction from the council about workshop dates for August?